On today's Men of the Apes, it only took 7 episodes before we all looked at each other and said, who's doing the tease? And nothing came up.
We are determined to know what the apes want, war or peace.
They are the good humans, and the dead humans.
And if it is man's destiny one day to be dominated, then oh please God, let him be dominated by such as you.
Welcome to Men of the Apes, daily podcast, where we break down every minute of the Planet of the Apes movies, 1 minute at a time. I'm Todd, that's Sean, and that's Richard.
Hello.
Yes, we got to pep this up because it is a dark, dark movie, but here
it's
we are.
Dark Tuesday.
Minute 7. I don't think this movie's going to have any bright anytime soon. What do you guys think? Did you expect it to be this dark 7 minutes in? Did you expect this?
Well, okay, so you showed me the trailer at the end of the last movie, so I know that there's going to be a war of some sort, an uprising of these apes fighting against their masters. So we know that's going to happen. I figured it's not going to be a shiny, happy movie.
And for anyone that's new, we always have to say it, Sean has not seen the classic films.
Nope.
He's watching these truly 1 minute at a time. Richard and I have. That will balance out when we watch the Tim Burton film, and then we'll flip it around when we get to the new ones, which Richard has not seen, and Sean and I have.
That's why I often
ask Sean what his opinion is and where he felt this was going
to
be banana.
I don't have to print out scripts and do all that kind of shit that Richard's doing. Damn.
Actually, that's really good. I think Sean should have to do the script
part. I know.
Part.
So, we haven't even talked about what this minute is.
Okay, so Sean, tell us what's going on with minute 7. Since Richard's raring to go, he's got points.
All right, we're going to start minute 7 with Armando and Milo, a.k.a. Caesar, walking through the promenade, and ends with Armando and Milo watching as a chimp is assaulted.
If he calls him Caesar one more time, can you just switch it?
He calls him Caesar one more time.
Okay, yes. One more.
Yes.
All right, let's take a listen to minute 7 of Conquest of the Planet of the Apes.
As minute 7, we've got a courtyard's worth of gorillas, chimpanzees, and I think orangutans, Milo, and a planet's worth of humans.
So it was at this point in minute 7 where I wanted to bring up again Century City Shopping Mall. Man, if that's built late 60s, opening in the 70s, what does that say about what they thought
what
people
modern
wanted?
Aesthetics are?
Wow, because there are a couple of shots in this right away where it literally is. I understand why the production scouts went and said, whoa, great.
Oh, this looks like the future.
Straight lines, squares, harsh. Everything about it is just very blunt. There's nothing warm and welcoming.
I mean, this is the first moment we actually get to see the signs, the buildings kind of in the background, but they're kind of like the Zeus signs. They're like this brown on gray with just the name of the business. You wouldn't notice them if you weren't paying attention to them. There's nothing visually eye-catching in the windows.
Well, I mean, even going back to what we were talking about yesterday with advertising and stuff like that, there are no billboards or anything. Today, you know, everywhere, you know, unless you're in a neighborhood like we are, and if you're in a city and you look around, you're going to see advertising of some sort. And there is no advertising anywhere in here.
It almost brings to mind when you watch Handmaid's Tale, when they send the handmaids off to the grocery store and how just starkly white they are.
Mm-hmm.
This is almost the flip of that, you know, where it's the stark browns and grays with no verbal communication whatsoever anywhere.
Yeah.
Other than what you hear the scary dude saying over the speaker.
The people aren't even talking.
Oh, right. Yeah.
I mean, the people that are walking.
The guards and everything, yeah.
That's exactly what I was alluding to.
So the note that I want to make about this minute, and it started a little bit in the minute before when Caesar noticed what was happening with the apes that had congregated. This next minute almost is from Caesar's point of view. We're watching his discovery of what this world is like. The angles are low. We see a scenario where a gorilla is sweeping and we have C2 guards come behind him.
And they do not care for how he's doing
that. They do not care. Yeah. In the script, he's supposed to get shot.
Oh, my.
Oh, okay.
In the script, the slow-moving gorilla who leans idly on his broom, the policeman appears behind him, jams his electric prod into the gorilla's back. The gorilla roars, turns, and sees the policeman grudgingly resume sweeping along the curb.
So today...
After a moment, the policeman turns away. Instead, we just get two policemen... kind of looking disapprovingly at the gorilla. Right.
Today would be it wouldn't be a shock with a prod. They would all have collars and they'd have app and they'd say ape whatever pink and hit him.
Yeah. And they'd shock the ape. But that was supposed to happen. I have no idea if they dialed that back because they thought it might be too offensive, even though it's about to get offensive.
As soon as you said that, I thought that's got to be a director going, okay, I get what you're doing. It's a little harsh off the top of the movie. This is the top of the movie. We got plenty of time to explore that idea. Well, and if you kill the ape now, when you kill him down here, it's not shocking.
He might be trying to build the moment, that's about to happen anyway.
Yes.
So we're still seeing this. We're watching kind of Caesar's eyes.
Milo.
Dart along this chaotic scene. And then we see a young chimp sitting on a bench. Now, according to Dane, the... script instruction is that the bench is supposed to say not for apes.
That
would be totally different, yeah.
But for people that are listening to the audio, there is a female chimp sitting on a bench, and she has several packages in her hand, and she seems to be tired.
Oh, real quick, the script is supposed to say not for apes, so we're assuming that apes can read, but they can't talk? All right. Sorry. Anyways, in the script. Sorry.
Well, they can see the symbols. They understand what the red diamond.
Oh, that's
and the
true.
Not red
yeah.
diamond means.
All right.
Well, I wonder if the reason you don't put that sign is that the Civil Rights Amendment was passed in '64, so this is only shot
less than ten years later.
Do they almost think that that's too much?
On the nose.
They're just going bam because this is fountain for whites.
What you do is you put humans only, not for apes. You put humans only.
Maybe that's what those pictures they're hitting at the first should be, is an X over ape, human is, you know.
Yeah.
I mean, so part of the commentary in leading up to this, the documentary, is that Dane and the producers saw that a lot of the black audiences were seeing themselves in this experience.
Yeah.
Well,
even though you had a white actor, a white British actor under a mask of what appears to be a black man, they understand what was going on.
Right.
So you wonder to what extent they're trying to make those connections without necessarily upsetting or offending the audience. How do we draw those conclusions without hitting you over the head with it and pointing it out? Hey, this is about race, even though we all know it's about race.
Well, it's an interesting idea, you know. So we kind of beat them up for just retelling the story originally, but the idea that this is Caesar's first time in the city is an interesting way to introduce it through his eyes, the oppression of his people.
So Caesar could have done that a little bit earlier.
Yeah.
And that's I think that the fault is it would have been, again, coming from the helicopter, coming from that perspective,
mm-hmm.
we could have done a little bit more with his point of view in terms of seeing all this stuff. But that's what this minute is about, him observing this stuff that he's never seen before.
Right. And so it's definitely, I mean, without question, his first time in the city, right? They don't say it, but it's so implied.
And
it's not
just makes you, and obviously I don't know if they address this later in the movie. It just makes you wonder what Armando was doing for 20 years, keeping Caesar away from all other apes that he is so confused by seeing all this.
Well, he could be that overprotective father that's keeping him away for the fear of losing him.
But you would also assume that this stuff has been covered on the news, that Armando would let him kind of know that kind of – be covered on the radio.
But maybe he's afraid, and I'm trying to think – there are examples of this, but the I'm not going to let you see it because if you see it, you'll run off and join it or fight it.
It's, So Milo has been living in the village from M. Night Shyamalan.
That, or he's Luke Skywalker protected by Uncle Owen, who doesn't know his true lineage.
No, but see, but Luke still knows about the outside world. He's ready to go out there and join the academy and all that kind of stuff. He's not ignorant. He's ready to go.
This is an
Milo has been kept in the dark for 20 years.
But then again, Luke is a human, and humans are throughout their galaxy. The idea of a talking chimp is entirely different because it completely turns everything on its head.
So this ape is sitting on a bench.
Thank you, Richard.
And she is tired. Dane originally wanted...
Is that what she is? Is tired?
She's That's
tired.
What I would assume.
Dane originally said the sick ape reaches the bench. We did not see her get to the bench and sit down.
No.
She's already sitting on the bench. Stares uncomprehendingly at the printing, sick ape. Then half sensing there is something wrong in what she's about to do, she lowers herself onto the bench into a sitting position. Two policemen descend upon the younger, wielding his truncheon. Off, off, no, don't you see the sign? Older policemen take it easy, they can't read. No, not yet, they can't. And the sick ape wanders off. Instead, what we get is we come upon the scene of the young ape with her packages, obviously passed out and tired. We don't know that she's sick. We just think that she's exhausted.
Exhausted, that's what I thought.
We should have seen totally beads exhausted. Of sweat on her forehead or anything.
So the two...
Or her dropping packages as she's trying to walk over.
The two Nazi officers, they call them police, so they're distinguished from the guards before.
Okay.
Come in, and they kind of jostle her, poke her a little bit. She kind of shuffles. She drops her packages. And then they shock her. What was intended for the sweeping ape a little bit earlier is now done to this ape. And I wouldn't be surprised if they had made a choice to use the same masks and prosthetics they used for Zira, because the ape bears an uncanny resemblance to Zira in the way that they did this.
I didn't look
she,
at that.
She, to me, looks like Zira. Well, now, I mean, granted, they all kind of sort of look the same.
They make all the female.
She does right there.
But I feel like they were trying to make the connection that we're watching Zira being tormented.
Yeah,
that was my thought.
For lack of a better term, they give all the females feminine hairstyles, like that little bob kind of thing.
Yeah.
That they don't do to Milo and stuff. So, yeah, all the females are female.
She to me, for this moment, I was like, oh, they're hurting Zira.
I didn't catch that, but I see what you're saying now.
Now,
one thing that I want to make sure that we don't forget, too, is there is a shot roughly the middle of this minute where we look and there are two sets of police booted feet that we're looking through.
Right,
as
we are, yeah.
And that, you know, if you go back to when we talked about Beneath and a lot of the problems I had when they tried to create the military and they didn't have enough costumes and whatnot, and how we were talking about how you could have, you know, 10 people with the boots on, go a low angle shot, and the boots walk past, and then the first people go back and start it again, so it creates this loop of people. Well, this is exactly that same principle, because technically all you still have to have are two actors. You aren't showing their face. It's a wonderful way to inject the presence that somebody's always there watching you, that there are those feet. Thompson, I am so impressed just 7 minutes into it with the silence storytelling that he's doing. He completely finds ways to put it where it needs to be.
It was very effective. My only note on this scene is if that were Snyder and Gal Gadot, we would have seen their asses.
Spinning around.
Yeah. Or does he do a lot of...
That Justice League film? Seriously.
I've watched that maybe.
There's a scene where we have Wonder Woman on the bottom of steps, and we have heroes at the top of the steps, and it's her boots. But Zack Snyder wants you to know that you can see her ass, and her ass is prominent in the shot. It's so intentional. And then, like, the flip side, suddenly it's like a Whedon scene, and it's, like, brightly lit. I mean, I looked at that, and I'm like, there are their boots.
Well, now I'm going to have to watch it,
damn. I immediately thought to myself, oh, my God, if that were Snyder, I would see their asses right now.
Well,
which brings up, and we need to talk at some point and an in-between, does Zack Snyder still deserve to be getting feature films to direct?
We
need to talk about it at some point. That's all I'm saying. Because you brought that up, I've wanted to know that question. We got to talk about that.
Can we talk about the genius oratory script writing that comes in this part of go, go, no, no. And then I'm expecting, ho, ho, fo show, what up?
Thank you, Sean.
Sorry.
There's no real dialogue in this moment.
Well, isn't this the moment, though, that has Caesar asking how did it happen? Doesn't he ask that question? Or does it hit in the next one?
Yeah, that's the next minute.
Okay.
But we got teased with the random in memorandum statue. They walk by it, but we're about to come back to the next
moment. So we all have to admit, I can understand why the guards might be a little pissed off for these apes, because the one washing the windows just kind of throws water on the windows